So on a day which is about friendship, it is a particular pleasure to introduce someone who is one of my great friends. Dr. Connie Thorb wrote her doctorate at the University of Alberta in Edmonton on intergenerational memory, how we relate to the events of our parents' and grandparents' lives. And during that, she came for a year out to explore some of the theological connections with the psychology of memory here in Blackfriars, and did me and Father Conrad the great honor of studying with us. And she's gone on to work as a postdoctoral researcher at the Center of Philosophy of Religion at Notre Dame University, and is now at Columbia University in New York as Assistant Professor of Clinical Psychology in Psychiatry, and cross-appointed as researcher in, at the New York State Psychiatric Institute. And today she's going to be telling us about divine friendship in times of depression, insights from neuroscience.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you for inviting me. I'm so honored to be here. As Father Peter mentioned, I came to study some theology in addition to my psychology while I was a graduate student here. So it's a particular honor to be here. I take responsibility for any theological misunderstandings or things that I might say that might be messed up, but anything good, I give complete credit to Blackfriars. So I'm a psychologist. I'm not a theologian or a philosopher. And so I'm coming at this a little bit differently. And I hope you'll bear with me, and I hope I don't do violence, as Professor Tacklett said, to the philosophy and theology aspects of this. But what I'm going to do is talk to you about divine friendship, not human personal friendship like Professor Pakalik focused on. So my talk will take more of a theological perspective on times of depression. So I do research in depression, and I'll present some scientific findings to you today from that, and try to put out some theological perspectives and reflections from my perspective on that, and then hopefully it'll spur further discussion for later on. So, let's see. Okay. So just a quick outline of what I'll be talking about. So first I'll try to just give a little bit of background on depression and the spiritual life, and I'll talk about it from both clinical and some theological perspectives. Then I'll go into the research project that I'm conducting at Columbia University, and that's a project on individuals that are at familial risk for depression, and I'll present some neurophysiological findings that we have on that. And then I'll try to come back around to depression and sorrow and look at it from a more theological perspective to try to tie it together a little bit. And I have to give credit to, it's actually a wonderful book if you're interested in this topic. It's called The Catholic Guide to Depression. It's written by a Catholic psychiatrist in conjunction with a priest. And it provides a lot of valuable information on this topic. And it's not just for Catholics, it's for anybody, particularly Christians, because it tries to merge the two areas. So I'd like to begin by talking about first what depression is not, at least how I understand it, and what I think are some misunderstandings, just so that we're clear on how we're going to approach this. Some people think that depression is purely a material physiological condition, and so they often attribute explanations of depression and the human person to just chemicals and these chemical processes in the brain. And I don't believe that that's the case. Some people say that depression is a sin and that it's some kind of spiritual failure on the part of the sufferer. And I would like to get away from that notion here in this talk. And they basically say the sufferer is somehow at fault for their depression, whether morally or not. And from that, it also extends to include the possibility that the person with depression should really be able to break free of their depression if they so choose, that it's in their power and that they can break free of it at will. And so from my perspective, that's completely backwards. The way I'm approaching it is that the human person is a unity of body and soul, and it's precisely the innocence of the person who's suffering with depression that's key in these discussions. And I would say that healing does not depend or rely on the sufferer themselves, but rather on the grace of God. And so that's the setup for this, this presentation. So then what is depression? It's a complicated question. Just for our purposes here, in a very basic and general sense, it's a deprivation. And people often think of it as a purely emotional kind of disorder or issue. But in fact, when we look at it more deeply, it includes the physical, the cognitive, and the emotional. It's a combination of all these different factors. And so I'll just go through some symptoms or the ways these things can manifest. And I'm talking about major depressive disorder here at this stage. And that's what the data that I'll be showing later is going to reflect on as well. And so these are, I've kind of simplified it a little for this talk, but basically if people experience any of these symptoms, about half of the symptoms that I'll list, for more than 3 weeks in a row, then they might be diagnosed with major depressive disorder. So you might know somebody, you yourself might have been through some of these things. I think we experience a lot of these things in different points in our lives to different degrees. And so anyways, you can kind of reflect on that for yourselves, and I'll just kind of describe this so we know what we're talking about. So depression can manifest physically. It can be presented as a lack of appetite. Sometimes people lose they don't eat as much. They don't have the appetite to eat. They lose their sensory perception in their taste buds, even, that food just doesn't taste the same. And then in atypical depression, it can be the reverse, where people actually eat too much, where, you know, they go a little overboard with eating. Lack of sleep, that's a very common manifestation of depression, that it's very difficult to fall asleep, or falling asleep all right, but then waking up every 1 or 2 hours in the middle of the night, or waking up extra early, say 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning, and not being able to fall asleep again, that no matter what a person does, it's difficult to fall asleep. So the circadian rhythms get off kilter oftentimes. There's also this lack of normal movements, what they call motor retardation, where it's almost like the person might feel like they're moving underwater, as if against, you know, this energy or this grain of something, some force, and that it's very difficult to move, and you can actually see slowed movements in people who are experiencing depression. And this it's connected to this lack of energy, that there's just a low energy that's connected. Cognitively, there's also a lack of an ability to focus and concentrate. And so really thinking itself becomes oppressive and burdensome to the person. It's difficult to read a book, to follow the line of thinking, to follow conversations, and to engage in thought and being really focused and concentrated to make decisions. It can become nearly impossible for people who are suffering with this. There's also a lack of perceiving positivity in sensory experiences. So they've done some studies where they show people who have a depression pictures of people's facial expressions that are neutral. And if they ask what emotion is being portrayed, these people will often detect negative emotions. So they'll be looking at a neutral expression, but they'll see sadness or anger or a threat. And so there's this kind of tunnel vision for the negative that comes through. And then, some emotional ones. There's a lack of joy and pleasure and hedonia. People often think depression is sadness. It's not necessarily sadness. But it is a lack of joy and pleasure. It's a slight difference. There can be sadness, obviously, as well. There's also a lack of desire, lack of desires to fulfill quite often. There's just a lacklusterness with desire and things to do with goals. There can be a lack of belief in meaning, purpose, hope, which is commonly understood as such, and a lack of belonging and relationship to God, to others, and to the world. There's a sense of isolation and seclusion. And I think this is an interesting perspective. Dr. Andrew Solomon at Columbia University talks about you know, that the opposite of depression isn't necessarily happiness. It's not sadness versus happiness. It's actually the opposite of depression is vitality. And so that's something to keep in mind as we go forward with this. So just, I'd like to just touch on some origins of depression in clinical psychology. From a clinical perspective, it's complex, and there are many explanations, and people include several of these things. But they include things like chemical imbalances in the brain and in the hormones and things like that. There can be genetic predispositions for developing depression. Physical and psychological trauma can often result in depression. Deficient interpersonal relationships, socioeconomic factors like being in poverty, living in poverty, things like that, not having a job, and some cultural factors as well. So to switch gears and then consider it from a theological perspective, I'd like to jump over to the other side and discuss just some of my thoughts on the theological origins of depression, possibly. So, arguably, I would say that the most basic purpose of the human person is to love. And I think that's at the heart of when we're talking about depression. So a person's emotional life is essential to be able to love and to be loved, first by God and then others. And humans were made by love for love. And emotions, our emotions, draw people in and vivify these loving relationships. So there's an intimate and intricate connection between emotions and our ability to love and be loved. So according to Christian revelation, I would say that humans were not created to be depressed, that they were created rather for authentic love that's found in and through self-giving relationships, that is friendships. And so people often ask, so did God create depression? And I would say, no, God did not create depression as such. And that depression, I'd say, is not original to human nature. Just like other diseases aren't original to human nature, like cancer or diabetes or Alzheimer's. And the good news, I suppose, because depression is not original to human nature, according to divine revelation, the possibility to be healed and freed of it does exist. So if depression isn't original to human nature, from where did it come? So Christian revelation, I would suppose, would locate its origin in the fall, in Adam and Eve's decision to disobey God and break relationship with him. And so as a result of falling out of communion with God, human nature was deeply wounded. And as such, emotions were no longer harmoniously integrated with the intellect, the will, the body. And then depression was unable to enter the human body and soul as such. And so as a consequence of being descendants of Adam and Eve, all human persons are born, therefore, in a state of original sin. And by that here, I mean that original sin would be lacking in the intimacy and friendship with God that he intends for his people. And so this loss of full communion with God opens up a space within the human psyche for profound sorrow and suffering, and that includes all mental infirmities, including depression. So then what would be the point of human existence after the fall? Is the next line of questioning. And according to Christian revelation, the whole point of existence since the fall would be, in this context, to reestablish full communion with God through the operative grace of God, through the Spirit of Jesus Christ. And so it's to rekindle intimacy and friendship with God. And so the sacraments can be part of this. And so although, say for example, baptism removes original sin, and it's interestingly, precisely through uniting a person intimately to God, it doesn't remove the effects of original sin. And so importantly, although depression can sometimes have roots in personal sinful choices, that's not usually the case, and that's not where I'm going to go with this talk when I'm talking about, especially major depressive disorder. And so, just to reemphasize that depression here is not punishment for personal sin, it's a consequence of original sin. So, depression, it's a complex issue. And it's important, I think, also not to spiritualize depression prematurely to the exclusion of psychology and biology. And so I'd like to take on this perspective here that healing depression requires actually a joint approach that includes medical science, psychology, philosophy, and theology. So does cultivating friendship with God affect depression? Now I'd like to turn over to the other side and say, what does the science say? Is there any evidence for this in science? We've kind of framed it, we've put it within a theological context. So do we see this in science or not? So I'll tell you a little bit about this research project that I've been a part of for the past 2 years at Columbia University. It's called Understanding the Role of Belief in the Resilience of Families at Risk for Depression. And it's for a scientist, it's a wealth of data. It's a great treasure of data. It's over 30 years worth of data that we have from families that are at high risk for depression. And since it's been collected for over 30 years, it's included about three generations into the fourth generation already. So we've been able to follow the original people over multiple generations, looking at their children and grandchildren to see how depression is transmitted across the generations and what factors help it and what factors harm it or incite it more so. And they're primarily Italian Catholic families from New Haven, Connecticut, that middle class families that the study is based on. And so the study design is, here I have a pointer, so we have the high-risk families, and in generation one, this was around in 1982, we got the proband persons they were outpatients from the psychiatric hospital in New Haven, Connecticut, and they were admitted originally and were diagnosed and treated for major depressive disorder. And then we got another group of families, the low-risk families, who were age and sex matched a sample from the same community, also from New Haven, but had no history of any kind of psychiatric disorders. And so then we could compare these two groups and then follow them across generations. And so you can see that, say, this person was depressed, the depression can go across generations, but it also doesn't have to. There are people who aren't depressed also that are still in the high-risk group. And in the low-risk families, there can still be people who are depressed, but there aren't as many and they're not at risk according to this lineage. So this is the study design and the people were followed over all these years. And this is just I can't really read it, I think, but it's basically, there were six waves of data collection. So baseline, year two, year 10, 20 years later, 25, and 30 years later. And at each wave, these were the measures. So we did these clinical batteries. These are psychiatric assessments of the people to look at various disorders, not just major depressive disorders, so substance abuse and addictions, anxiety disorders, all kinds of things. And so those were collected actually at all the waves. And then 20 years into it, technology was coming around and blossoming. And so we started to collect neurological measures as well. So in year 20, we started to collect EEGs, electroencephalography waves that are measured, and then MRI and also DNA we started to collect and analyze. So you can see that there's a wealth of data here. And importantly, at wave three, year 10, was when we started to collect some information on religiosity and just ask some very basic questions, and we asked them at each subsequent wave. So there are about four waves of religion data as it relates to depression. And the religiosity items were very simple. This is just in a psychiatric assessment, so it's very simplistic. But they're basically, what is your religious denomination? Most people were Catholic or Protestant in this sample. How important to you is religion or spirituality, from not important at all to highly important? And how frequently, if at all, do you attend religious services? So based on these three items, all of this other data and the findings emerged. So this is, here's a spoiler alert. I'll just tell you the result, and then I'll go into the studies themselves. The biological correlates of religiosity were shown to be protective against depression. And so this was replicated several times in different ways. And this also occurred, we'll have to mention that we control statistically in the analyses for the effects of age, for gender, for history of depression and anxiety, for parental history of depression and current depressive symptoms. So once you factor all those things out, you still got this protective effect of religion against depression. And we found this structurally, functionally, and longitudinally. So one study, the structural one, this was, we examined brain structures using magnetic resonance imaging, MRI. And so just looking at the structures of the brain, and in this particular study, we focused on cortical thickness, so the cortex of the brain. And just some background information, cortical thinning has been associated with a greater risk for depression. And so our hypothesis was that high religious importance would be associated with thicker cortices. If it's protective, then you should see thicker cortices rather than thinner ones in people who are at risk. And that's indeed what we found. So we found that people who reported high ratings of religious importance had thicker cortices than those who reported less religious importance. And this effect was uniquely observed in the high-risk group, in the high-risk families only. And so it suggests that religious importance provides some kind of protection against depression. And interestingly, religious attendance and denomination had no statistical effect on these biological correlates of thickness. And since no talk in psychology these days would be complete without a picture of the brain, I just put one up for you. And it basically doesn't tell you much, except that's a little section where we found cortical thickness happening. And interestingly, it was the same region that showed cortical thinning in a previous study in the people at risk for depression. And this is difficult to see, but here, it's basically, this is the low-risk group, and this is the high-risk group, and you can see that there is greater cortical thickness in the people who said that religion was highly important to them than those. And it looks like there's barely a difference on this graph, but it is statistically significant. That's what that little star is. And it's in science, and it's a good thing. It's a big effect because it's statistically significant. Even though it might not look that way. So that was one study. Another one, we looked at the functional aspects of the brain, and we specifically looked at the default mode network. So here, instead of looking at a specific structure in the brain just at a static point in time, it looks at the blood flow in this particular region of the brain as it's functioning, as it's in the brain process is in process. So we used resting state functional MRI to look at the default mode network. And just some background on the default mode network, we found before that increased default mode network connectivity has been shown to be related to things like empathy, daydreaming, and, interestingly, depression. And so one way you can look at this is it might be related to rumination, like when people start thinking a lot about, even if they're empathizing with another person or they're daydreaming, and people who are depressed might get into this loop where they can't really break out of this, and so that's maybe related to the inability to focus and to make decisions and concentrate on other tasks, because this other part of the brain gets overactive, and that can cause that sense of apathy that is often experienced and observed. And so in depression, there's that rumination that might be happening. So there's this increased overactivity in the default mode network in people who have depression. So we wanted to test, and we hypothesized, whether religious importance would decrease default mode network connectivity. And that's what we found, was that it decreased the connectivity. And again, it was uniquely in the high-risk group, not the low-risk group. And again, it just suggests that religious importance is somehow associated with protection against depression. And again, religious attendance and denomination weren't implicated statistically in this, in these findings. And so here's a graph, and it, you can basically see that here for this is the degree of default mode network connectivity as a function of reported religious importance. So if people said it was very important in the high risk group, there was less default mode network connectivity than if they said there wasn't. And so you can see this separation between, between the two. And the third study is a longitudinal one. This one we looked at EEG alpha. Those are amplitude waves, brain waves that, that are measured. And we wanted to look at this longitudinally across 20 years since we had the data and see what might be happening. And so EEG alpha specifically, it's been known to be associated with relaxed mental states, clinical responses to antidepressants, and it's been observed in experienced meditators. So we thought it might have some connection with being, you know, more religious or not. And it's also been associated, the greater the amplitude of the EEG alpha waves, the more protective it is than against depression. So we want to look at this, and we thought that people who reported high religious importance would have greater EEG alpha, regardless of the time point in which they reported that. So whether they report it now that religion was important to them or they reported it 20 years ago. And so what we found was, we didn't quite find that it wasn't necessarily connected with that. There was actually a critical phase, it seemed like. So the people who reported initially in their youth, in their early 20s approximately, that religion was highly important to them had higher and greater EEG alpha waves. Regardless of what, if they changed their importance ratings later, 20 years later or not. And it suggests a potential critical phase, which I'm not sure what to make of quite at this point, but it's interesting nonetheless from a developmental perspective that if you develop religious importance earlier in life, it has protective effects potentially 20 years later. And I'll just show you a confusing diagram of this to kind of show you the data. So this is importance at time 10, right? So at the 20 years ago. So people who, and then these are the alpha waves, the posterior alpha waves. People who said that religion was always important to them had fairly high, I mean, there's just a few of them, but they had higher alpha waves. The people who migrated out of this group 20 years later, so they no longer felt that religion was as highly important to them, retained these higher alpha waves, whereas the people who became more religious over the 20 years and said it was highly important to them, they had lower alpha waves, so they weren't connected. And people who never found it to be important, religion to be important, it was kind of 50-50. It was, yeah. So, an interesting finding, and it suggests something for that critical period in one's life. So the summary of these experiments, basically, we found these biological correlates against of protection against depression in specifically high-risk individuals who reported religion as being highly important to them. And these protective effects were observed structurally, functionally, and longitudinally. So they're kind of compelling. Findings, I think, as a psychologist. But what do they mean? And so this is where science can get a little limited. So currently, we actually have a John Templeton-funded project where we're collecting a wider range of measures because, as I shared with you earlier, we only had these three measures that we were using for religiosity. And so right now, we just finished collecting data on a survey that looks at the different dimensions of religiosity so we can determine, basically what is religious importance? What does this mean when someone says it's highly important to them? Is it the social function and support they receive from the religious community? Is it because they've developed a personal relationship with God? Is it that they consider it's important and because they have religious objects in their households or something? So to kind of break it down and understand what this means more. And so this is new data coming out, and hopefully we'll be able to understand some of these findings in greater detail. But as I said, science on its own is rather limited in the explanations that it can offer. And so, with respect to today's theme of divine friendship, I just want to bring this back and consider religious importance as it might relate to divine friendship, and which may in turn then provide protection and resilience against oppression. Moreover, I'd like to put forward, and I don't have time to develop this further, but I would say that in the findings, at least in the scientific findings, there is space for an explanation for God's grace that is active in the scientific findings at biological, cognitive, and emotional levels, that it does not rule out the possibility for God's grace. And I think that's interesting. You couldn't say that within a scientific community, but here I can share that, and it might mean something to some of you. So one thing with the findings that I thought was interesting is that the effects were specifically found in the high-risk group and not the low-risk group. And so I was thinking about that, and I was thinking, you know, it might be that God is present to people in these places where we're actually most at risk, where we're most vulnerable. And so there are different places in our lives where we can be vulnerable. I mean, it can be through genetic mutations. It could be just our lot in life, socioeconomic statuses, illnesses, disorders, dysfunctional relationships that we might experience, sometimes society itself, where bad ideas might be proliferating all over the place. And as St. Paul says, in our weakness is our strength. And this would connect with that notion. These findings would connect with that notion. And specifically here, for this topic of this conference, this strength may be found through divine friendship and relationship with God. And so in this very last part of the talk, I'd just like to touch upon depression as sorrow. And I said earlier, major depressive disorder is not necessarily sorrow, but when people talk about depression, they often do think of sorrow. And for those who are interested in this topic, and I think everyone can relate to sorrow, and so I'd like to consider some potentially redemptive features of it, of depression and sorrow, within a theological context. And so basically, what might be something good that can come of it, and from a theological sense? And I would say that depression and sorrow can remind us that we're not yet home, that there's this longing, and this it can instill a restlessness and a desire and a holy longing, if you will, for something greater. And it reminds me of St. Augustine's famous quote that our hearts are restless until they rest in God. Moreover, for Christians specifically, union with Christ cannot occur without sharing in his cross. And so there might be a participatory aspect that is available to Christians through suffering, through sorrow, and through depression. And actually, Professor Packlett touched upon this as well, and I want to echo that this is also exemplified beautifully through Our Lady of Sorrows, who shared so fully in Christ's suffering. And her suffering depicts a suffering that's born of love. And so it basically is showing that depression, when it's embedded within a spiritual framework, that joy and sorrow aren't mutually exclusive. In the Beatitudes themselves, it shows that those who suffer are indeed blessed. So Pope John Paul II also said that depression is always a spiritual trial. And I think that's true. Depression isn't only spiritual, I think, but it is always a spiritual trial. And so just to end with this last notion of sorrow as a call to interior conversion, and that it can help deepen the potential for friendship with God. And I have a quote from Rilke that I think summarizes and expresses this rather beautifully. So he says in Letters to a Young Poet, "You have had many and great sadnesses, but please consider whether much in you has not altered, whether you have not somewhere at some point of your being undergone a change while you were sad. For they are the moments when something new has entered into us, something unknown. Our feelings grow mute in shy perplexity. Everything in us withdraws. A stillness comes, and the new which no one knows stands in the midst of it and is silent. We could easily be made to believe that nothing has happened, and yet cannot say, and yet we have changed, as a house changes which a guest has entered. We cannot say who has come, perhaps we shall never know. But many signs indicate that the future enters into us in this way, in order to transform itself in us long before it happens. And so within a theological framework, we would say that the person's ultimate end is God, is in God. And the guest entering us in this way through the transformative power of sorrow may be God, God's action in us. And so sorrow can be this a way to cultivate character and virtue. Rilke extols this, the value of sadness, as a clarifying force in our interior lives. And it can cultivate this character and virtue within the person in order to prepare a person for their ultimate destiny, divine friendship and union with Christ. And he says, we will also gradually learn to realize that that which we call destiny goes forth from within people, not from without into them. And so according to this view, the end is not some time point in the future. It's a constant transformation that's happening within each person in the present. And so depression and sorrow can be recruited toward the end that finds its ultimate rest in communion with God. And at its best, depression can be a remedy for human fallenness through the cultivation of friendship with God. And to end with a line from scripture, when sorrow was great within me, your consolation brought joy to my soul. Thank you.